Keith Pompey, The Inquirer, covers the Philadelphia 76ers. And I'll tell you, Keith, I've been at a lot of games this year. I know you're at more than I am, but I've been to a lot. Friday night and Sunday afternoon, the energy in that place, I don't know that has been matched. I don't know that you can admit, say that the energy Friday and Sunday has been matched all season long. Would you agree?
Yeah, I would also say last year, you know, even after they had Ersan and Marco, you know, like, and they went on that 16-game winning streak towards the end of the season to conclude the regular season. I mean, that was something different last night. I mean, it was, like, really electric in that building.
And I'll tell you what, Friday night, you got the 83 team there, and then Tobias hitting the three, and just the way it went. You got a chance to see Tobias in person now for these two games, and you just got to say, like, this was the piece they were missing. There were so many opportunities on offense, Keith, where there was a dribble drive or something happened, and then there was a kick out. And typically, that guy might have been Wilson Chandler, or that guy might have been, you know, just a mid-level player. Having Tobias be that guy, that really has changed the dynamic.
I agree 100%. I mean, and think about it. You know, when when Jimmy Butler first came, you know, Embiid complained about his role, and a lot of people thought he was upset with Jimmy. He was just upset with his role. And now you have a guy in Tobias Harris who fulfills that role in regards to, you know, playing in the perimeter. And as you look at it, JJ, things are easier for JJ Redick. I mean, he's benefiting the most. And then Ben Simmons, yes, he did shoot a three yesterday.
Witness.
But it's one of those things now that Ben Simmons, no one is concerned about him not shooting the ball now, you know? So it's like Tobias comes in and he erases everything. The spacing is together. I mean, it's just – I mean, he's a better player than I thought he was. You know, I always thought he was a good player, but you're looking at him now, you're really dissecting his game, and he's much better than what I thought.
Yeah. Can you talk a little bit more about Ben Simmons? Because now – before, it was like Ben Simmons has to score. He's really the second or third option. Now he's kind of like the fifth guy. If you score 15, 20 points, that's unbelievable. But he's going to be in that 8 to 11-point range now. And what he can really settle into, my opinion, you see if you agree, Keith, is he can go and excel at making everybody else better.
You're exactly right. Now, it's funny because, you know, Ben Simmons was very active yesterday. Like, he was aggressive. I don't know if it was because, you know, because he was playing against LeBron. And I could hear people in the stands saying, no, Ben, no, don't shoot that, don't shoot that. And before they were like, why don't you shoot it? Because they know now he can be just the facilitator and get everyone involved, like you said, and they'll be very, and the team will be very successful. So it's like it takes a lot of pressure off of him, especially now that he's an all-star. So, to me personally, he can say, like, look, people already know I can play. I can become this distributor. I do not have to be aggressive. I do not have to shoot. Now, again, he's going to have to shoot the ball some in the playoffs. But right now, his goal is to get everyone else involved, grabbing rebounds, dunking. You know, and I think he'll excel in that.
Keith, two things that have been an issue that I think anyone that follows this team, even somewhat closely, have understood that it's been recurring for them, which is turnovers and lack of depth. And yesterday, 7 turnovers, just spectacular in single digits there. And then for me, since this trade, and really even a little bit before that, but especially after these trades, is the bench and the depth. These guys coming in these games now are basketball IQ. Their basketball IQ is high. They're tough. They're not afraid of the moment. They're taking shots. That, to me, is something that's going to finally separate this team and at least give them the weapons to make a potentially deep playoff run.
Yeah, you're right, and that's what it is. And, you know, I do think that they're still one piece away. Like, I think they need to get a shooter, you know what I mean? They need to get a shooter to come off the bench. A lot of these guys are defensive-minded. But when you look at it, you look at their age, they're like, a lot of these guys are 29, they're 30. Like, you know, as Brett Brown said and Elton Brand said, the time is now. So they have grown men who are making grown men decisions. And regards, like, you know, Wilson Chandler was a grown man, a quality player, but he was a little bit injured. But then when you look at it, you got Mike Scott, you know, you got James Ennis. He's a little bit younger, but I believe that this is factoring in that the reason why this team is, you know, better and it seems like they're deeper is because they're older and they're more mature and they have a better or a higher basketball IQ than some of the younger players they had in the past.
What's been your favorite lineup, Keith, outside of the starting five, which we all love now, but what's your new favorite lineup? Like, what's something that you've seen over the past two games rotation-wise that you're saying, wow, this is a nice move, or I like this player with this player, anything that stuck out to you?
I mean, to be honest with you, I know this sounds crazy, but I always like seeing when Boban and Tobias are on the floor together.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just funny to me because you look at them and they're like, and it's not like X and O lineup, but like you look at the two, and you every time I see them, I'm always thinking about their, you know, they're like their YouTube video and this and that. And when they're on the court, it's like they're just straight serious. You know what I mean? They're,
yeah,
like, really focused. And another guy who I like seeing playing, regardless of who he's out there with, is Mike Scott. I like Mike Scott because, you know, he's like, kind of the unheralded guy of the group. He's an undersized power forward, but he's gritty. You know, he goes out there and he does what he has to, and he brings that toughness. And he can shoot the ball. So, you know, right now, the Sixers are really experimenting with a lot of different lineups, you know, to see who could go out there and play together and play well together. But those three guys really stand out to me, you know, when they're out there on the floor playing.
Keith Pompey is with us from the Inquirer. The Sixers take on the Celtics tomorrow night. Yeah, what do you think, you know, Brett has said it a lot. In fact, he said it the day of the trade, like, you know, we need to get veterans. It kind of was like a precursor that all of a sudden that bench went from the youngest, mm-hmm, you know, bench that you had, and then all of a sudden you got guys, veterans all over the place. But you talked about Boban. Is Boban the guy, or is it matchup-based, or do you think he's the perfect guy to kind of back up and beat a position they really haven't had since Joel has taken over? They really haven't found anybody to stabilize 15 to 18 minutes back there. Is Boban the right guy for that, or are they going to mix and match like based on matchup? Because he did say yesterday in his pregame that he's mindful of Bolden a little bit.
Yeah, I think, you know what, I think Boban is more of a matchup type of thing. Like, you know, you know, if you want to go small ball, you know, he might not be the guy for you just because of the running up and down. Like, you know, yesterday it was a kind of up-tempo game. Now, he did have 10 points. You know, he shot well, but he only grabbed, like, one rebound. You know what I mean? He did block a shot. But I think that if you're going to go with a smaller lineup, that's not the game for him. Now, but if you're playing big teams, you know, you can – you know, utilize his strength like in more of a half-court game. So I think that, you know, he is the right pickup because, you know, you're around and every move that the Sixers are making is all for the postseason when the game is more slows down and more of a half-court type of thing. So I think he'll be better suited for that. So that's a great one. But in right now, like if you're playing a team that wants to get out and run, you know, I just think that, you know, that's a bad matchup for them at this particular time.
Everything now, Keith, they got the players, they got some depth, comes to the coach, right? And how do you think Brett is doing? I know it's very early, but just in general this year, I mean, people are very critical and he's got to do this and he's got that. And you look at their record and you're thinking, man, this guy can't do anything right for these people who are critical. But do you think that Brett has done a really good job of implementing these guys in such a short amount of time?
Yeah, he has. But you know what? Unfortunately, he's in that position where regardless of what he did in the past, you know, it's going to come down to, like, you know, you have a roster now, and the roster may not be complete in regards to, like I said, you need another shooter. But if Brett Brown doesn't go far in the playoffs, there are going to be some who say, like, hey, you know, we have everything, but we just don't have the coach. I mean, it just goes with the territory.
Do you agree with that, Keith?
You know what? I mean, you know, it's tough for me to say that because it's kind of like, all right, it just depends. Like, let's just say, like, if they go into a game and Ben Simmons is throwing the ball all over the floor, Joel Embiid has an awful game. It's not Brett Brown's fault. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But regardless, though, if they go out in the second round of the playoffs or get upset in the first round of playoffs, I mean, people aren't going to look at Elton Brand and say, hey, you're the GM. How come you didn't do this? How come you didn't upgrade the roster? Well, he did. So if rightly or wrong, I mean, it's always going to come down to the coach.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I always felt like Brett Brown in the past, people weren't fair. Because if you look at the roster, there was always someone hurt. You know, they were always making these mistakes. And sometimes you can say, hey, that's on the coach.
Even this year, Keith, their losses this year, it seems that every time they lose a game, someone's been out.
Mm-hmm. Especially in the starting five.
Yeah, exactly. Yep, exactly. And it's more or less Embiid. You know, I hate to say it. Like, you know, this is where you know how dominant Embiid is. I remember when they went to Portland, and I forget how wide the margin was, but I want to say like 30 points. It probably wasn't that wide, but Embiid didn't play, and they lost by 30 or something.
Yeah.
The next day he comes back, and he plays in back-to-backs. He's averaging 35 points, 19 rebounds, and 2.5 blocks, and they win both of those games by an average of 5 points. Right then and there, that tells you how dominant he was for this team and how much he had to be dominant. And now you look at this roster right now. Embiid, the first game they played against Denver, Embiid shot, I believe it was 4-for-17. Ben Simmons committed 9 turnovers, and they still win because of these new additions and because of, Tobias and J.J. Redick. So in the past, that would not have happened. And that's the reason why Brett Brown is going to get, you know, regardless of what happens, if they win, he's not going to get the glory. They're going to say it's the players. But if he loses, unfortunately, he's going to be the one that everyone's going to blame.
Tomorrow night, Boston. Is this an important game mentally for them to say we can beat Boston? You know, I've said before, look, they lost to Boston twice, both games in Boston. But now the game's here. Is tomorrow night important for you, Keith, to prove something to themselves?
Yes. And today at practice, Brett Brown said it wasn't. But it is. I mean, because there's a mental block. Like, Boston is the team that, for whatever reason, they just can't beat. You know, I mean, they won one game last year in the playoffs. They lost a close one on Christmas. You know, they were kind of blown out in the season opener by Boston. I mean, and I know some people are going to say, but Kawhi's not playing, it doesn't matter. Well, Kawhi didn't play last year, and Boston won, you know, the series in 5 games. I think that this is a huge game for the Sixers. Now, I do believe the next time they play, when they play next month, the Sixers are going to be a better team because they'll have more time together. But, however, moving forward, I think that this is a vital game because then it becomes mental. Like, it's always in your head. Last time they lost, Joel kept saying, we can't beat Boston. You know, it's not a rivalry. We can't beat them. So I think that, you know, right now, tomorrow's game is more important than the 76ers want to let on to.
Keith Pompey, The Inquirer, right now in the East, who do you like? Milwaukee, Toronto, Boston, Philly?
You know, I still have to go with, and until the Sixers beat them, and I know the Sixers look good, and it was electrifying. But until the Sixers, like, can beat one of these teams, I'm going with Milwaukee number one. I'm going with Toronto number two and the Sixers third. You know what I mean? They could move on up. But right now, I just have to go with that order. Milwaukee number one, Toronto number two, and Sixers third. Now, you got to realize these two teams upgraded their rosters as well at the trade deadline. So, you know, that's the order that I'm going into.
Toronto added Jeremy Lin today, by the way. Keith Pompey from The Inquirer, and he appeared via the Boardwalk Honda Hotline. Good to see you the other night, Keith. I'll probably see you tomorrow night.
All right, hail to Pitt, bro.
Take care, man.
Get out, man.
Keith Pompey, a fine Pitt grad.
Unbelievable.
Here on the Boardwalk Honda Hotline.